6 after 1, half an hour before that in sunny Broken Hill. Well, normally I say to John English when he tells me words are not enough. Sometimes I say yes, hand gestures are often required to get your point across. But today we're not going down that track. We're actually going down the track of our face and what they tell us. Was it the Delphic oracle that said, know thyself? And of course, the other great mystic saying is, the eyes are the window to the soul. Well, joining us this afternoon is Alan Stevens. Alan has been compared to many great people. He has over 30 years' experience in basically summing people up, in being able to cast his eye over someone and have a pretty fair idea at what may constitute their character, what drives them, what lights their fire, perhaps what extinguishes it as well, and perhaps what they should be doing with their life. He's done a thing called psychometric profiling, which is very interesting, as well as neuro-linguistic programming. And for those people that have done that, they'll be nodding saying, oh yes, NLP, that's really helpful. Also body language, micro and subtle expressions, and reading personality traits. And normally when I have guests in the studio, it is the guest who is hand-wringing and saying, oh, I'm so nervous. But today it's Meryl with the sweaty palms. I'm nervous as to what Alan's going to say about me. Alan Stevens, face profiler, welcome and hello.
Thank you very much.
I really am quite honestly nervous, Alan. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I didn't wear any makeup, my hair's not looking that swish, so it's take me as you see me today, Alan.
Well, the good thing of looking at facial features and that, just seeing someone's beauty in their personality.
Well,
so
thank
it's probably
you.
That.
It's interesting because radio is an interesting game because I don't get to see people's faces, but I get to hear their tone and their voice. And it's very interesting for me, particularly over the last 5 years of doing intense talkback. I think that I've developed my own system of being able to read personalities and, I guess, not so much a full personality profile, but at that point in time when that caller phones, just from the tone and the expression, the language that they're using, the kind of voice that they have, in some sort of auditory way, I feel as though I've been able to do a very small portion of what it is that you've done for all these years. So I get what you're trying to do, Alan. I totally understand that you can actually make a pretty accurate assumption about someone just by casting an eye. And of course, it's more than that. I realise that it's a science. But tell me about how it is that you got into this, Alan. What led you to your path of facial recognition?
Well, I think probably because I started off being very poor at reading people anyway. And I decided that I needed to know more. But as you mentioned, I was working with psychometric analysis, where Myers-Briggs disc programs like those where you would ask questions to work out someone's personality. The only problem, when you ask somebody questions, they're asking themselves, how do I answer this? What's being asked here? And they try and second guess it.
They're sort of countering the information or trying to tell you what you think they want you to know.
That's right.
Yes.
And because we use those for job selections, we quite often get the wrong people employed in the organisation because of the way they've answered the questions. So the only way to really read them is to take the emotions out of it and don't ask them any questions at all.
Okay.
Now, you just alluded to a moment ago that you can read people through the tone of voice, etc. Well, when it comes to communication, the words are only worth 7%.
Mm.
The tone of voice, about 38%, and the rest of it is the body language.
Mm, which I can't see on the radio.
But on what actually happens, the words only go from 7% to 17%. The body language transfers into the tone of voice.
Mm, okay.
So you're still reading it. Everybody reads. Mm. All I do is just bring the scientific understanding back into it and train people on so they understand what they're seeing and recognise that it is accurate and not just their biases or imagination that's picking it up.
Yes, because that's the other thing. People, I guess, perhaps do what's often called mind reading or second guessing, and they try and factor in, oh, well, that might be just my bias on it. That might be what I'm imagining. Is that something that goes on as well?
That happens a great deal, and that's where the uncertainty comes in. People quite often judge themselves, you know, am I right? And that's when they miss what they've actually seen. Your first reaction is usually pretty right, but then you also have to look and go, okay, if you're looking at someone's behaviour, for instance, the person you're looking at might have a similar face shape to somebody who has done you wrong in the past. So straight away,
there's conditioning.
You're conditioned to that. Now you then behave in a certain way to them. They pick it up because they're also unconsciously reading you, and they then respond back, and you've created a self-fulfilling prophecy.
And that's the miscommunication that often
comes
in.
That's what happens.
I find that really fascinating. So it's almost like when people say you are a mirror of yourself. It's like, well, hang on, someone may have done something to me. Oh, I'm not so sure about you. You give off those vibes and all of a sudden there's that friction, if you like. And
that's
when people say, oh, I didn't like him from the moment I saw him, or I didn't trust her, or, you know, that is interesting. Those gut feelings are very strong, aren't they?
That's right.
Now, tell me about the idea, because this is not just about you being able to read people. This is about sharing your skill set and knowledge with the rest of us so that we can use these, and not just to be judgmental, if you like, or make a judgment, but also to learn to communicate better, and also using it with children, and also helping us to think, well, hang on, what is it that I should be doing with my life? There's a far broader reach for this than just Alan Stevens being able to look at me and say, well, this is the sort of person you is. You are. You want to share it with us all, don't you?
That's right. You can use it with anybody, for say, from the cradle to the grave. So newborns, you can see particular traits where if you're able to recognise strengths that they have, then you can guide them through their early years.
We were just talking about Prince George, weren't we? And you said you hadn't had a chance to get a look at Catherine and Will's new baby, but you're eager to have a little bit of a look at him.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Because there can be anything up to about 10 traits you can see in a newborn.
Wow.
So things like music, I can tell you whether they're going to be a fidget, especially when they get to school. And that's where the next stage comes in, is when they first go to school. Teachers being able to recognise their learning styles, and therefore being able to moderate the way they teach that particular child without a great deal of effort and time on their own behalf, and help those kids from, or prevent them from falling through the cracks.
Just incredible.
Then help kids before they leave school to find the right careers that will suit their personalities.
So are there major things that we can say about someone by looking at their face, Alan, or is it really too sophisticated to say, look, you know, this person's got a flat sort of... No, so that makes them generous, or that makes them... You know, we're not talking about that so much. It's more sophisticated than that, isn't it?
Well, it starts out with that, because a particular... If you think of anybody who's been lifting weights, working out,
yes,
you can see that in their body.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing in someone's face. The face is just a history. When you said the eyes were the windows to the soul, the facial features are the windows to the mind.
Okay.
So that when you, if you take an expression over and over again, you're going to build muscles up.
Mm.
Say somebody frowns a great deal, the corner of their mouth will start to turn down and stay down because of the stronger muscles.
I've got this crease across my forehead. I think it's from going, oh, okay.
That's right. Those little vertical ones there tell me also that things are going to be exactly right when you're looking at them. So as far as detail and things like that,
I
become
like
important.
Yeah. Well, let's launch right in. Come on, I'm here in front of you. You tell me about me, and then we can branch off to other people like Tony Rudd, Kevin Rudd, and Tony Abbott. There's a morph that would be interesting. Let's go headlong into it.
Okay. Well, first of all, there's about 68 traits, but the first thing you see in someone's face is the width of their face.
Mm-hmm.
You can start to profile somebody as they're walking across the room towards you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the first thing I see in the width of the face is the wider faces are the people with a higher level of initial confidence.
Okay.
People with narrow faces like mine have to build their confidence by doing things over and over.
Okay, so wider the face, the more confidence
more
initially.
Confident. Now, the thing to remember, first of all, is that there is no right trait and there is no wrong trait.
No.
And every trait has an upside and a downside. So those that are more confident in the moment, in the first instance, may miss some detail, whereas the narrow-faced person may take longer to get there, but they will have more knowledge, or more likely to have more knowledge. If they're speaking confidently about a subject, it's pretty hard to question them and catch them out, because they wouldn't be talking confidently unless they knew that knowledge.
So perhaps someone with a wider face would do well to hold back a little and take more in.
Take
and
more in.
And that's how to make yourself better.
So if I'm actually have someone there who's got a wide face and I'm imparting knowledge to them or information, and I want to make sure they've got it, I'll remember to actually ask them more questions.
Okay.
To confirm that they've got it, whereas a narrow-faced person, I'm just taking more time to allow them to take it in.
That's just fascinating.
So it allows me, as soon as I look at somebody, to know how to communicate with them, to help them get to where they want to go, and for me to get out of it what I want to get as well. So if I'm a boss, I want to make sure that my people grow properly and are very functional in their work and very happy and productive. Because happy staff and, are more productive, and your income goes up in that business.
Okay.
So it's in everyone's business benefit to work together.
Excellent. So what are you going to look at me now and do me? All right.
That's right.
Okay, sure.
Okay. Well, as I said, the width of the face is the first thing that you see. Mm-hmm. Now, with yours, it's a more wider face, not as wide as some, so it's more towards the initial self-confidence.
Okay.
The second thing we notice when we first walk up to somebody is the height of the eyebrows.
Mm-hmm.
People with very high eyebrows are more discerning, so we give them more space. They're just as friendly as anybody else, but initially they take their time to make up their mind.
Okay.
You're more towards the affable, which is similar to myself, where we're quite happy standing close to people.
Yes.
When we first meet them.
And I didn't kiss you today because I was nervous about you, but I am a social kisser. You know, I'll often shake someone's hand and give them a peck on the cheek and just say hi, welcome.
That's
know?
Right. We're very quickly around the table, up to me, shaking hands very closely.
Yeah,
so,
and
that's the affable side of it.
Okay.
Then there's the width of the eyes, the space between the eyes themselves. The wider the set eyes, the more tolerant the person is.
Okay.
The closer they're set, the more we focus in on things.
Okay.
Now yours are a little bit more towards the wider set.
Yep.
Whereas if you look at mine are more towards the middle, the inside set.
Yes, yes.
So in your case, when it comes to if you were doing a task and very busy and I needed your help, I'd be fairly comfortable in coming over to you and saying, look, I need your help as soon as you can come over.
Yes.
Whereas somebody like me with a closer set eyes, it'd be a case of pointing out that I recognise that their work is important and everything else. I really need their help. How much time do they need before they can put theirs aside and come over and help me?
Right. Yeah,
so I drag them over now. They're still going to be thinking of their stuff when they come and help me.
Interesting.
So it's all about communication.
It is all about communication and getting what both people want. So that person, perhaps with the closer, narrower set eyes, it's saying to them, look, I acknowledge that you're busy, that you're a very focused person. If I could take a moment of your focus, and in that way, they'll be more conducive to saying, look, this person understands that I'm busy and that I'm focused, but because they've understood that, I'm happy to divert my focus momentarily to help you.
That's right.
Fascinating.
So the next trait I look at is the actual eyelids themselves, whether they're exposed or they're concealed.
Mm. They were much nicer when I was 20, Alan. I didn't have these hoodie bits. I don't believe in plastic surgery, but if I did, that's what the first thing I'd have done.
Yeah, when somebody looks straight at you, you look at that, and on mine, they're partially covered, mainly because of my age, but also a lot of it is due to the work I do.
Mm.
The more concealed they are, the more focused you are in the actual moment and in the information, the more information you need to make a decision.
Mm.
So,
that's going very close to the bone for me. I need tons. Ask Becky when we're about to do an interview. I have reams and reams of research and paper. I will not do it unless I'm fully briefed and prepared.
That's right.
It hit me in one.
Yeah, so somebody who's got the exposed eyelids, don't go and tell them too much detail because their eyes will just roll back in their head. You get the shark eyes.
Mm.
But somebody, you can still understand the big picture. You might want the big picture, but you won't make a decision until you've got all that information. Now, that means you may take longer to make a decision on that one point, but all the facts will be there before you make that decision.
Okay.
99 times out of 100 for the person with the exposed eyelids, they're going to be fine. But that one time out of 100, they might need that extra information.
Okay.
Whereas you won't have that particular issue at all.
Okay. All right.
But you also even though you need all the information, you make your decisions fairly quickly once you've got that information.
Mm.
And that's another one of the... There's seven traits that I've actually put into a new app.
Mm.
And that's one of the...
I want to talk about
come
that,
into that.
That's a great way for others who are hearing this today thinking, oh, I'd love someone to do that to me. Well, you can actually do that with Alan's app. You can go and use that. So we'll tell people about that at the end of the conversation.
Excellent. So the other thing is, too, that when I first look at your eyes, there's a sparkle to them.
Okay.
It's what we class as magnetism.
Okay.
So people are going to find it very easy, even out of this setting, say just sitting in a social setting, the person will be very quickly to come and tell you their life story and everything else. And I'm sure on occasions you've found people just telling you stuff you didn't really want to know in the first place.
Oh, it's funny because I get that a lot. And obviously this is my job and I ask people to phone and talk to me and I love it, but it happens to me so often. I'll find myself in a situation and people just literally download on me. And I don't mind, but it's quite interesting how comfortable people feel with just going, oh, and then this happened. And I'm thinking, do you really want to tell me this level of information? But I used to be known as the vault at the last place I worked because so many people confided so many things in me that I just decided never to tell anyone anything else about anyone else because I knew too much.
See, anybody who's got that, it's not only the colour, but it's a sparkle.
Okay.
But it's also one trait that can change quite dramatically and very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
It's related to stress being on the other end.
Mm.
So if you're a person who's got the bright, sparkly eyes and you're getting attention from the opposite sex that you didn't really want, that may be one of the reasons why you're getting it.
Okay.
And that's where I then advise that person's partner not to look at their partner as being someone who's flirting. It's not them, it's the other person's response to it.
Okay, all right.
So this then moves into looking at counselling and all sorts of issues where it can be used.
Yeah, just fascinating.
So it just rolls on and on.
Yeah, so am I done now? You reckon?
Those were the main traits, but one, as I said, you've got those exacting marks, which is having things exactly right.
Yes.
Detail as well, not only getting all the information, but also making sure you understand all of it.
Yes.
And when you look at traits and we give them names, sometimes the people look at the name and go, oh, well, I don't really feel comfortable with that name.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the ones that I can see with you is a nose for news.
Nose for news, okay.
So it's a trait called nose for news, which is all about being able to pick up all the information, all the news on a broad scale.
Yes.
And then it's your other trait, the meaning all the information, that's when you would then drill down into that information and become a bit more investigative.
Yes, exactly that.
And you've... Well, I would say you get reasonably fussy about making sure everything's right.
Yes.
Now, I've got a trait which is called a dry sense of humour, which is an opposite to your trait. Where you have the more fussy, things have got to be more exacting, etc. With me, with a dry sense of humour, I've got to be careful about the words that I use and the jokes that I might come up with.
Okay.
That you don't take it personally.
Right.
Now, it doesn't mean I don't take things personally, because if I realise I've upset the other person, then I'm going, oh, well, what have I done?
Yes,
and
of
I take that reaction against myself then.
If you're listening this afternoon, I'm chatting with Alan Stevens. Alan Stevens is the face profiler, and you can find him, Alan, A-L-A-N, Stevens, S-T-E-V-E-N-S, .com.au. So if you are listening to this thinking, this is one of the most fascinating conversations I've heard for years, please go and check out his Facebook page and also his web page. It's wonderful. And there is a new ebook available from Alan and a new app, and we'll get to that in a little while. But if you just tuned in this afternoon, you're listening to Alan Stevens. He's the face profiler, and it's not just, as I said earlier, a curiosity or a party trick. This has got some real potential to help people decide what they want to do with their lives, and also help children enormously who may have difficulties at school and teachers, and there's a whole realm of use for this. Alan, just closing off on me now, am I in the right job, or should I be doing something else?
You're pretty right.
Pretty right.
You're obviously enjoying the work as well.
Oh, I'm so happy to hear that. I was thinking I'm going to have to pack my bags this afternoon and go off and be, something completely different.
No, I generally find if somebody's had a look at their traits and their traits seem to line up, they're enjoying their work, their traits are pretty much going to be there as well.
I tell you what, Alan, we're going to keep chatting for another couple of moments, and what we will do, we'll go and take some news at the 1:30 mark and come back and continue the conversation.
Right, yeah.
If that's okay with you.
Excellent.
So we've also asked some of our listeners to send some photographs in. So if you want to do that, we've got a couple here already, two or three. If you want to do some, we'll keep taking those, and we'll pick a couple to do that on. But tell me about the work that you've been doing with school children and teachers, Alan, and how that has panned out. And there's one particular case of an aspergic child where you've really made a big difference, isn't there?
Yeah, well, that was probably the best place to start. He was 6 years old at the time. His mother was working with me on another event. I was doing an event called How to Avoid the Psychopath and Other Practical Dating Tips. It was for their singles group.
Right.
And when I profiled, I said to her, look, send me these photographs in, because he's got Asperger's. He's not likely to sit around still while I'm there, but he'll take some photos just with you. And she said, yes. I said, well, send those photos to me. From the photos, I profiled him and then gave some ideas you could take back to the school. Now, because the teachers were pretty much at the end of their tether with him, they put it in place. Now,
fantastic.
2 years later, he's now up in front of the class and also the other the year doing presentations, which
isn't
is something
wonderful.
They couldn't ever see him doing before.
And also the teachers were so impressed that they invited you to come and work with them at school. Is that true?
That wasn't from that particular event,
sorry,
but that was then used to talk to other teachers. East Maitland Primary School were extremely interested in it, and very good that they actually asked me to come in and have a session with them. And I did an 8-week program, which was after school, one day a week, going through those traits. Now, in the first session, they actually learnt things about each other that they didn't know about, and they've been working together for years. They then got their interests flying, and then we started looking at the children, and they got an understanding of the different behaviours and why the kids behaved the way they did.
Mm.
So it gave them a lot more knowledge on how to read those kids.
Mm.
And as the principal told me, they're finding it more and more difficult to read the kids, and here was an example of being able to do it.
Wow, that is amazing.
So my focus is to try and get this into every school.
I think it's fantastic. I'm going to get you to have a look at Beck, my producer, too, because we've been working together, but I think we could probably, you know, I'm open to improvement of relations, even though we get on so well already, but I think you can never have too much information. I think it's a wonderful thing.
Well, that's exactly right. It's used for the right reason. The more information, the better.
Fantastic. Alan Stevens is the face profiler. He joins me at the moment. We're going to go and take some news, pay some bills, and come back and do a little bit more of this face profiling. Very interesting stuff. If you want to send a picture, just send it to www.2smsupernetwork.com.